Welcome to our brand new show, The Retro. My name is Tracy. You can follow me on Twitter at Lady Leet. And I'm joined by my amazing co-host, Rob Ocell. You can follow Rob on Twitter at Rob Ocell.
Great. Yeah. Really glad to be doing this. So first of all, The Retro, Tracy. What is The Retro? Well, The Retro is a... a thing that we do on our projects, and we want to look back on kind of the things that we've been doing, maybe stop for a second, have a conversation about what things worked, what things do we maybe want to do a little bit better, and what were some of the cool things that happened. So, and that's what we're going to be doing in this show. We're going to be taking a look at, you know, the conversations we've been having with each other and what we can learn from them. We're going to be talking about people and some of the interesting things they've been doing lately. And of course, we're going to be talking about the really cool tech libraries, releases, and things that got us super excited in the recent weeks.
So, Rob, what are we going to cover in the show today?
So today we have a really interesting show. So in the subtweet, we're going to be talking about Tailwind CSS and all of the successes and the fervor and conversation that surrounded that. In today's
The Water Cooler,
we are going to be talking to Chris Gardner about C#, game development, and Twitch streaming. So if any of those things interest you, you'll definitely want to stick around. And in our DoubleClick section, we're going to be talking about some new cool routing technology that was just released for Angular that everybody should be trying in their side projects.
Cool. Let's go ahead and get started.
Great. Let's go. And now it's time for the subtweet, the part of the show where we review what we've been talking about as a tech community online and give you the information that you need to have in order to have more educated and more informed discussions about it. So Tracy, this week we're talking about one of my favorite libraries in the world, which is Tailwind CSS. So if anybody isn't familiar with Tailwind CSS, it's a utility-first CSS library created by Adam Wathen and his team of people that work with him on that. And it is just an amazing library that people have really taken to. Like, it has had a wildly successful couple of years. It is widely adopted. In fact, it was just announced this week that there is first-class support in Rails. So in the main Rails repository, right? This was announced on DHH's Twitter. It was now in Rails, in one of the main Rails repositories. They have a Tailwind Rails connector so that you can easily integrate Tailwind into your Rails applications. What an amazing tool and what an amazing week for Tailwind. But at the same time, nothing can get popular without also having some detractors. And so another sort of conversation that was really big on Twitter this week was an article written by Jared White talking about why Tailwind isn't for me, where Jared lays out a very personal and a very reasonable set of examples and ideas for why he doesn't like Tailwind on his project. Now, as always happens whenever you invoke any sort of popular library in a negative sense, this brought on a lot of conversation, a lot of people either defending Tailwind or attacking Jared. And so people like Sean Wang took that opportunity to retweet and relink one of his articles called Why Tailwind CSS. This was from back in October, but it lays out all the reasons why he did think that Tailwind was the future. So there's all this conversation going on, but to me, what's really happening here is that I think JavaScript developers, and in this case, CSS designers, have found what we've been missing for years, which is just the framework wars. Everybody feels that whenever a library gets too popular, they either have to learn it or bring it down a couple of notches so that they don't have to learn it or don't have to use it or don't have to put up with people talking about it. At the same time, when a library gets big, its community starts to get so rabid in their fandom and so fervent in their devotion to it that if you attack it, you can just be mobbed by a bunch of people that are trying to defend it. So I don't know, Tracy, I mean, what are your thoughts? This does sound very 2016, 2017 to me, you know, React versus Angular versus Vue. When you kind of hear these conversations or see these things going over your timeline, I mean, what should people be thinking about or what are you thinking about?
Oh, so many things. I think community is really important. So like the first thing I get concerned about is, you know, making sure that there is some positive voices and making sure that there's like good community leaders within that. So that's one, that's kind of like a side thing, right? But I think like it's really interesting to hear that, you know, now Rails has that first class support for Tailwind CSS. That's really cool. You know, I always say our JavaScript ecosystem just gets like bored and, you know, needs to fight over something else, right? Like, you know, Webpack was the new thing and now it's like all these new compilers and bundlers, right? And, you know, with Tailwind, it's kind of interesting because, you know, because of all this, you know, fighting or chatter that's happening in Tailwind and these the articles written, I wonder if a new Tailwind will come and will it be like, okay, for competing with each other, right? Or is it just going to be like Tailwind, no Tailwind, and we leave it at that? So I'm curious to see how that goes, but I think conversations generally, whether good or bad, help inspire innovation. So I hope that our communities can kind of take to this in a positive way and it creates, you know, better products for us to make us better developers.
Yeah, there's also something here to be said about community. You know, it's incumbent on any developer that feels that they're building a community. And honestly, the Tailwind community has some of the most friendly people. I mean, Adam himself is extremely helpful, extremely generous in what he gives to the community of his own time with streams and technology and such. People like Sarah Dian, who's just one of the most amazing developers, writes a lot about utility-first CSS. There are so many more people that are love using this tool and love working in this space. But when you're building these communities, if you see people dogpiling on someone for giving an opinion, you really need to do your part to try and, you know, project positivity, not fake positivity, but you really do need to shine things in the right light. And that's just another lesson for Twitter in general, which is to anybody that wants to give a review on any framework or any reason why you prefer one strategy over another, it's always going to be more engagement to phrase what you're saying in why certain technology is bad, but it's going to be more productive in the conversation threads below if you say why you prefer a certain technology to solve a certain problem. Because I think that's what everybody in Tailwind would say. It's not that Tailwind is a perfect CSS framework that solves every possible problem. It's reinvented CSS. There's no reason for any other strategy or methodology. Of course not. But it is a technology and a strategy which has worked for a lot of teams to avoid a lot of the typical problems that come up when people try to follow the old guidance or what was considered the old guidance of using things like semantic classes and semantic CSS. You know, are those approaches bad? No, of course not. But a lot of teams have found a lot of value from this. And I think when you're advocating for Tailwind, focus on that. Focus on what it gave you and the problems of yours that it solved. And if you're advocating sort of against it or for moderation, then maybe talk about the problems that you have that you had to find other solutions to. That's going to, I think, overall lead to a more productive conversation. And I think in general on Twitter, we could be doing a lot better job of that.
Yeah, but also it's not perfect, right? Like, if you go defending somebody and somebody else doesn't like it, maybe stay out of it, but project your own opinion. And then, you know, that own opinion could also be thrashed. So I don't know. I mean, there's no real, you know, good answer to how to approach Twitter, to be honest. But, you know, I think from a community perspective, right, like the more that we can be friendly to each other and assume good intent, the better the community is going to be overall. So I think that's an important thing to think about. When I look at Tailwind as well and frameworks, right, when I see like, you know, you look at like JavaScript and then they're like, JavaScript, okay, but I need a framework. Okay, we love frameworks. Okay, now let's build frameworks on top of frameworks, which is kind of the evolution that's happening right now. You know, I go back to like the, you know, the Rails ecosystem and kind of what they've built there. And it's like so cool to see that, like just such a healthy ecosystem and how it's just so easy for developers to be productive within that ecosystem. And so I'm liking to see JavaScript become a more mature ecosystem to where people are building those tools and we are being accepting of those tools, which, you know, again, I think progress forward, even with a few, you know, stops here and there, right, is definitely where we need to be going.
And I just think in general, people need to be more cognizant when they're giving aesthetic opinions, subjective opinions, in other words, because, you know, I recall there was a time when React was considered ugly. A lot of people looked at JSX and said, what a disgusting syntax. That's horrible, right? And now people find it, you know, either really intuitive or just they enjoy that about React. Similarly, I remember the first time I saw BEM, a different CSS style, and with the underscores and the dashes, and I said, ugh, who would ever want their classes to look like that? That's the most hideous thing I've ever seen. But then I learned more about specificity. I got burned by specificity, and suddenly I found myself longing for or almost reinventing the idea of BEM, and suddenly it clicked and it made sense. So sometimes our aesthetics are even temporary. So you might not like the look of Tailwind, but if you got used to it and you saw what it gave you, you might then suddenly not see anything else make sense to you. So aesthetics can be temporary. Oftentimes that's the personal response when your body is learning something new and it's rejecting the newness. So it's just trying to come up with ideas. I don't like that about it. I don't like that about it. And, you know, it always helps if people think when you're giving an opinion, how many of these opinions are aesthetic, subjective opinions, and how many of them actually would be valuable to somebody else if they heard them because they might agree in the same way. That's how you can help make sure that you're adding to the conversation and not just adding a lot of noise or dogpiling, because as soon as two people start disagreeing about an aesthetic difference, that'll never resolve. That's just a lot of shouting until somebody gives in. Great. Well, that is it for this section. So thank you so much for everybody. Hopefully you have more productive conversations on Twitter in the next week.
Yeah, and find us on Twitter. You can find me on Twitter at Lady Leet. And you can find Rob at Rob Ocell, O-C-E-L-L, on Twitter. And we're always happy to have little chats with you. Hello, and welcome to this week's
The Water Cooler
with Chris Gardner. Welcome, Chris.
Glad to be here.
We're super excited to have our little one-on-one with you. This isn't a one-on-one where, you know, it gets put randomly on your calendar and you're like, am I going to be fired in this one-on-one? Do you ever get those where you're like, sync, and you're like, what is that?
My boss is generally pretty good to warn us when it's not good news, so...
That's good. So like every time you have a one-on-one, you're like, you assume it's good news unless you hear otherwise.
Well, or at least neutral news.
Cool. Well, I know Rob has some questions teed up for you.
Well, so one of the things that I know about Chris is that he's actually a C-sharp developer. I was a C-sharp developer for many years. It is my first, well, it's not my first language, but it was certainly my first language love. And so it's always great to talk to another C-sharp developer. Chris, why don't we start out, like, can you explain a little bit about what area of C-sharp that you dabble in?
So I really do touch a lot of it, but mainly day-to-day and when I'm doing some of my other things, I am much more of a business logic back-end database type person. So at my actual job, I do a lot of the APIs and that thing back. And then we have other people who do the front end, you know, and the connection layer there. Through the years of working, it's always been, I've loved data and data manipulations and doing all that type of stuff. So that's kind of where my specialty went. And I've completely deep dived there and know all those parts, but I can get on a front end when I need to, and at least make something that, as I like to put it, isn't a UX nightmare, but is not going to win any awards.
Well, there you go. I mean, that's really all the best we can do is the best that we can do. So, you know, one of the things that's interesting about C-sharp, so that's changed since I was involved with it, is this idea of .NET Core. So there might be some people that have heard about C-sharp and they've heard of .NET Core, or they might have this old idea in their heads that, oh, I why would you use C-sharp? You can only use Windows servers and those are slower and more expensive. So can you explain a little bit for people that are maybe unfamiliar with some of the developments over the last several years about what .NET Core is and whether that's something that you're using right now?
Right. So originally there was the .NET framework, and it revised and upgraded along with the language as necessary. So you had .NET framework 1 and you had C-sharp 1, and as the language evolved, the framework evolved. And then a strange thing happened around C-sharp version 5, which was the .NET runtime 4.5, which is the framework runtime stopped being updated. The reason they did this was they didn't want to introduce breaking changes and to cause people to have multiple versions of the runtime running. So they managed to do everything in the virtual machine with compiler tricks instead of having to actually update the runtime. And this went for a very long time. We got a lot of new features in C#, supported up until C# language version 7.3, which is not the current language version, but was the last version. Finally, at version 8, they're not moving it anymore. However, at one point in time, because of not wanting to update the runtime, the virtual machine, things, of course, were in old tech, and there were a lot of lessons learned. So at one point in time, they said, okay, well, let's take our bread and butter, which is, I believe, why it was originally called Core, because it was a very small subset in the first revision. And let's say, here there will be breaking changes, here the runtime may need to be updated, but we're going to rewrite everything and fix the runtime so it is a lot more efficient and works a lot better. And in version 1 of .NET Core, there were only some things that worked, and then in version 2, they added more things. And now we're in version 3, which is fairly comparable to what you can do to Framework. So almost everything you can do in Framework, you can do in Core now. Some older obsolete technologies notwithstanding. But for any modern development, they're pretty much on par. And the newer language versions are now going. So .NET Core now supports C# 8, which takes a very special update to get to work in Framework. And now they're saying we're moving forward now only with Core. They're not fully end-of-lifing Framework, but they're saying at this point, all the new things are going to go into Core and what they're now calling just .NET without anything. It was called .NET 5. And I believe the reason for that is that it's the runtime is moving to 5. And then in .NET Core, they're skipping the version 5 monkier and going straight to version 5 so that everything kind of goes. And they're going forward with that now. So that's why there was the split for a while. But it was really so they could get in there and fix a lot of things. And if you run comparable code, there is also another thing you may have heard of called .NET Standard, which is basically I'm going to write a library that will run anywhere. And by doing so, there's only certain things you can do that, you know, it basically has to be something that is supported everywhere. But if you write something in .NET Standard, you can then tell your tests to run it against different frameworks. So I have a library written in .NET Standard. I have a set of unit tests that runs against it. And you can tell the unit test framework, hey, run this against .NET 4.7.2, run this against Core 3. And so I have the exact same code on both sides running in parallel with this nice little thing that tells me how long it takes to run because they're the exact same tests in a test framework. And I've gotten upwards of 10 times performance on Core running the exact same code.
Wow, that's really impressive, actually. And it's really cool to see the language thrive. And, you know, I know another reason why the language is thriving, which is super interesting, and I think it's an interest to both of us, is game development. Sneakily, for anyone not paying attention, C# is a great language to learn for game development, particularly through tools like Unity, and there's been many others elsewhere. So I know it's a passion of yours or an interest of yours, a hobby of yours. So if you, could you go through a little bit about your experience with game development? Like, how did you get into that? Like, how do you enjoy using C# for that?
Yeah, and that's actually a very interesting story, too. So originally back in the day, Microsoft created a framework for C# called XNA, which was its game platform. It actually had the tools. It ran traditional game loops, things like that, like you would expect. And the original idea for it was that it was supposed to be managed C++. So it wasn't intended originally to be a C# game development library. It was intended to be a way to have C++, which is traditionally used for game development, run in managed code. And then that evolved. It became XNA. XNA went through a long way. Well, one of the things people in XNA wanted to do was allow this game that was written in C# to run anywhere. So it created this project called Mono, which you may have heard of, which became Xamarin, which is how things run everywhere now. So that all spawned out of game development. But on top of that, the XNA project eventually died. before it died because all these developers had learned C Sharp as a very good introductory language to get into, you know, take their skills they already knew in C Sharp and use them for game development. As you mentioned, Unity picked it up as the basic language it uses for its scripting language. And so then it moved forward from there. And now the people who originally created Monogame have still kept up with it. And you can even still use those old XNA libraries and use Monogame and do all sorts of traditional development. And it really puts a different way in thinking, because a lot of people, unless you're hugely writing command line apps, which I know a lot of people do. I write a lot of them just for utility purposes. But your business code is traditionally more of an event-driven model in this big monolithic, whether it be an API or a front-end or a Windows app or whatever. It's generally this big event-driven thing. Something happens, you respond to it. Whereas games, much like on the command line, is you have a loop and you have to keep the programming running, because as soon as that main function ends, the program terminates. And there are lots of tricks of how to deal with that and how to keep threads locking and whatnot that comes with that, that I think if people just played around with it some and just did the game equivalent of Hello World, which is bring the screen up, throw a sprite on there, use some keys to move it around and keep it on the screen, and then close out. And they kind of understood how that's working. It really helps in your understanding of frameworks in general. Because even if you're used to using Windows and you've only done this event-driven model, hiding somewhere in the framework is that event loop that you're using just for a command line app. And knowing that that's there and understanding how you get in and out of it and what's working just really helps you understand why certain things are done within these bigger monolithic things where you don't see it.
That's awesome. One other thing about you, which is super interesting, that I know a lot of people are interested to hear about, is that you're a Twitch streamer. And, you know, 2020, a lot of people had a lot more free time and started to pursue a lot of side projects. And I think a lot of people really wanted to think about getting into streaming. So I guess to start off, could you kind of explain where people could find you on Twitch, a little bit about how you got into it, and whether or not you think people should be jumping in and starting their own streams, or if there's just too many people doing it now?
And also how to make tons of money doing it. Like, balling, right, Chris?
Right, right. I'm making so much money from it. Twitch has never given me a payout yet. I got started before, because, yeah, it has become very popular now that things have been locked down recently because of the COVID pandemic and everything, and people are looking for new ways to reach out. I was both lucky and unlucky enough that in my current job, I don't get the opportunities to go out and travel and go to conferences as much as I used to. So I talked to my bosses and was like, hey, can I start doing this? You know, we'll start on 2 days a week and I'll just do an hour and we'll see how that goes and go from there. Just as a way that I can scratch that itch of training people and talking to the community and teaching without having to do the commitment of now I'm traveling and I'm having to work, you know, the difference between at home remote and Uber remote. And so they wrote off on that. So I started mid 2019, you know, kind of ahead of things. And it, to me, as I said, it was, I like showing what I'm doing, talking to people about it. Hey, here's why I did that when they asked the questions. Here's my feelings on, you know, I've been doing this a long time. I have many opinions, both good and bad, and I'm more than happy to share them with you. So that's how I got started. And for anybody wanting to get started now, there's no reason you can't. There is a little bit of equipment you have to buy for the most part. And you can get away with some of it too. If you have a powerful enough computer, you know, with a nice enough graphics card, you could primarily just get started with the camera on your laptop. If you've got one of those ones that has a embedded graphic, you know, both a embedded graphics card and the discrete graphics card, you know, use the microphone on there. And just share your screen, have OBS running in the background with a simple scene going. And you can feasibly do it. And that's basically how I started. I mean, I'm now thousands of dollars worth of equipment into all this, but
with no payout.
With no pay. Well, I've got a payout waiting. So
Twitch will pay you. Hack Chris's Twitch channel. Quick.
That's right. Twitch will pay you once a month as long as they owe you at least $100.
Nice.
And I'm at like 76 right now. So I'm getting close to a payout. But you know, ads give you like 4 cents a month. That's the trick. But as far as somebody wanting to join, just don't expect to have everything fall in place right away. You're not going to start, even if you've got, a bunch of friends, you're not going to start and have every stream huge and get right to affiliate right away and get all these subs and everything right away. It takes time to build that community. It takes time to get comfortable being in front of the computer and expressing all your thoughts out loud and learning how to think about what you're working on while you're keeping an eye on chat so you can answer questions. And these are skills that just take practice, and it takes time to build that community. So when somebody gets started, I tell them, don't get discouraged. You know, let people know you're doing it. And one of the biggest things I found is have a set schedule. People know I stream Monday, Wednesday, and Friday from 1 to 2 p.m. Central. That's when my programming streams are. That's when you can find me. I have missed one day out of that schedule in the past year and a half because I took Christmas off. I decided not to stream on Christmas. But other than that, I very rigidly stick to that schedule. And over time, the community knows that's when they can find me. And I've built that audience and I've built that rapport with people. And I've got better at speaking on camera and doing all these things. And so that's what's allowed me to keep going and do it. So the biggest thing is just do it the first time and then don't just get discouraged and keep doing it. Like any other skill, it's practice.
Yes, I love all my trash shows. I still have this one. I've created a lot of YouTube channels, the time before Twitch online. Right. And, initially it was just like me eating macarons. Like it's still online somewhere where I'm like literally eating these lottery macarons and I eat like 20 macarons in a 5 minute period. And I felt really sick after that. But, you have to kind of, no shame. Ooh, no shame, no gain.
That's
like
right. That.
as a Twitch slogan. But where can we find your Twitch channel?
So I am on twitch.tv/freestylecoder. I do need to update some of the information on that page, but the schedule on there is correct. All the information's on there correct, except for the part that blatantly references 2020. So that's where they can find me. Feel free to follow, as I said, Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, 1 p.m. Central. So 2 p.m. for y'all. That's when I'm up there, and it's just me coding. And generally I'm working on some sort of project right now. I'm updating the website for the conference I run. Other times I'll go into F# and do some library type work, or I'll stay in C# and just play around with an idea or write some sort of utility that I think people can find useful. And all the code is always up on GitHub, which is github.com/freestylecoder.
Ooh, F# sounds like fun. Well, feel free to invite us to this conference. We'd love to come.
Well, it's supposed to be in September, so we don't even know if it's happening yet. But
cool, awesome.
Yeah, fingers
crossed. Well, thank you so much for joining. We loved this one-on-one with you. Again, everyone follow Chris on Twitter @freestylecoder. Check out his GitHub. Check out his Twitch stream. And, we really appreciate you coming on and hanging out with us.
It was a pleasure. I just absolutely enjoyed it. Thanks for having me.
Thank you.
Thanks, Chris. We had so much fun. Oh my God, you're like an encyclopedia of like the history of C# or like, yeah. So it was amazing. So thank you.
Yeah, the ability to rattle that off the top of your head. That was great.
I know. Well,
I had a talk I wrote right before everything shut down where I actually talk about the way the assembly language, the Microsoft IL that runs in the virtual machine runs. So I had done all that research previously for that anyway. And the thought behind the talk is if you understand how the VM is running the code, it kind of makes sense how you're writing the code in the first place, because it's getting interpreted down to this and you can kind of understand.
Yeah.
I just got lucky that I know all that off the top of my head because I did that research for that talk.
Awesome. All right. Well, we'll see you very soon.
Sounds good. I can't wait to be able to see people again.
Yeah, but seriously. Talk to you very soon.
Yep.
Bye. In this week's Double Click, we are going to learn about interesting new tech. And we have something very exciting from one of our friends in tech, Brandon Roberts. And Rob, do you want to share the little tidbit of fun things that Brandon just released?
Yeah, so we just got the notification that Brandon is now advertising that they have released their component router. So, you know, for anybody that this is for Angular, so for people that are doing front end JavaScript development and are using Angular, you know, you've basically had the same router forever, right? The Angular router that's built in. And so what Brandon's been working on is a new type of component based router. So something a little bit more declarative. If you're coming from sort of like a React background and you've used React router or Reach router in the past, it'll feel very similar to you, where actually the router doesn't live in a configuration file, but instead it's actually embedded inside of your components, inside of your templates. Now, why is this really cool? It's actually really cool because a lot of the things which are super powerful and potent, like the ability to use things like ngif or ng4 in your templates, are actually compatible with these routes as well. So instead of using the concept of route guards and things like that, you can actually use an ngif tied to an observable that's observing your, you know, is authenticated an observable like that. And so that way you can have these sort of private sections or admin only sections. And all of that is just piped directly through your components, which is something that a lot of developers are going to be a lot more familiar with. So it's definitely something to play with. It's still being developed. It's in the early stages. I'm not saying don't, you know, completely go and abandon everything right now and do a complete migration, but definitely play around with it. See if the ergonomics fit with you. And, you know, because it's a Brandon Roberts thing, it probably has some really great connections with technologies like NGRX and being really tightly wound up with, you know, being able to tie those observable streams together. So this is definitely something that you want to be playing with on your side projects in Angular, or if you've never used Angular before, if you're coming from a React background, you might do it because it might even sit with you a little bit better than Angular has in the past.
Cool. So exciting. Did this come from Brandon? Did this come from NGRX team? Or did this come from Narwhal?
It's a little hard to say. So, you know, this is kind of, you know, I don't know if they would call it this, but from my outward appearances, it's like what I kind of call NGRX Labs. You know, like Google had like Google Labs.
Yeah,
it's kind of like NGRX Labs with these like playful things that they're doing. They had... they had a component state or something like that, or, you know, component store a little while ago, which was sort of like a smaller version, condensed version of NGRX inside of a component, which wasn't truly NGRX, but not truly not that. So I kind of consider it to be kind of under that umbrella of NGRX Labs, but it's currently on GitHub under the organization Angular-Component. So it's Angular-Component/router. Is where you can find it, or just find Brandon Roberts on Twitter and you can find the link. But it's certainly a cool read. It's, like I said, because of its implementation in Angular, if you're familiar with the implementation in React, it's definitely something you want to look at just to see how some of the Angular framework insides give you an interesting spin on this concept. So, you know, I'm really interested to see Angular move even further in a declarative sense. I'm really curious to see where that will lead. One of the things that people has traditionally liked about Angular is that, unlike React, maybe to some extent, it tries not to put too much construction and meta knowledge into its templating system. It kind of prefers to keep that in the back and leaves the templates pretty close to HTML. So I'm really curious to see if this kind of coding style catches on, and if so, where it leads. Because honestly, I saw this sort of bubble up in Vue, and I don't know if it led to Vue 3, but in very quick order, we learned about people doing render functions in Vue, and they're like, oh, cool, you can kind of do this, that, and the other thing. And all of a sudden, Vue 3 was like, we've completely broke apart the concept of the Vue component, and now it's all in this declarative sense. And it's just been a really radical thing to see that community develop. So... yeah, we'll see where this takes Angular, you know, if this catches on, if we develop more. But this group of developers that are working on these tools, I just love that the Angular community just continues to innovate. And I love to see innovation even from outside of the core team, which is a super healthy thing for the Angular ecosystem. You know, whenever you have successful, healthy third-party libraries, that's just great for any framework community. So,
love it. Oh,